Good morning. Welcome to River Lawn Presbyterian Church. We're glad that you could join us this morning. We welcome you. A couple things we want to point out as we begin worship. This Sunday is All Saints Day. This is the day where we remember and think of all of our brothers and sisters who have finished their race and kept the faith and rest from their labors, those who've departed this life for glory. And so this is a time to remember. It's also a time to mourn with those who mourn, those who are grieving the loss of their loved ones, especially this past year, but also to proclaim the living hope, the resurrection hope that we have in Jesus Christ for them and for ourselves. So we wish you a happy All Saints Day. Also, today is the Good Samaritan Food Drive at the St. Albans Food Pantry behind St. Mark's Episcopal Church. You can go there between 1 and 3 o'clock today and drop off your food item donations. There'll be volunteers there to just get that food right from your trunks. And again, the need's been very critical these days. So hopefully you're able to support that. Even if you can't go today, there's still ways that you're able to make those donations to the pantry. If you have questions about that, you can let us know. Also, it's the first Sunday of the month, so we have communion. We're going to have communion via Facebook Live at approximately 11:30. So I encourage you to come back to the church's Facebook page then to have the elements prepared and to have your hearts prepared as we partake of communion, the Lord's Supper, together. And one other thing, we want to point out that next Sunday, November 8th, we will have our annual meeting of the congregation, and that will be to present the slate of officers to be voted on, of elders and deacons, to present the 2021 budget and to vote on that pastor's terms of call. So we invite you to be part of that meeting. Again, that meeting is actually going to follow the drive-in service, immediately following the service. And again, it'll probably be around 11:15 on the Riverlawn Church parking lot. And they'll be sending out copies of the budget beforehand, hopefully. You'll definitely have it day of, but hopefully before too. All right, so we have gathered here to worship. Let's prepare our hearts for that worship. Pam Johnson has prepared our prelude on the piano. Precious Lord, take my hand. Thank you, Pam. Let's go before the Lord in prayer and confession. Let's pray. Almighty God, Savior Jesus, hope of all who trust in you, Lord, you weep with those who mourn, even as you cry out in triumph over the grave. Lord, unbind us from sin. Release us from captivity. Raise us from death to life, so that we may join the great crowd of saints who forever sing praise to your holy name. Restore us, Lord. We pray all this In the name of Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, hear this good news, this assurance. This is love. Not that we love God, but that God loved us and that he sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Know that in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And let us, in that spirit, in that assurance, sing unto our great God, trust and obey. Now let us turn to God's Word as we continue our series on the book of Revelation. We come now to Revelation chapter 10. Let's prepare our hearts. Hear the word of the Lord, the angel and the little scroll. Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. His face was like the sun, and his legs were like fiery pillars. He was holding a little scroll, which lay open in his hand. He planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and he gave a loud shout like a roar of a lion. When he shouted, the voices of the seven thunders spoke. And when the seven thunders spoke, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven say, "Seal up what the seven thunders have said, and do not write it down." Then the angel I had seen standing on the sea and on the land raised his right hand to heaven, and he swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heavens and all that is in them, the earth and all that is in it, and the seas and all that is in it, and said, "There will be no more delay. But in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound the seventh trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished, just as he announced to his servants, the prophets. Then the voice that I had heard from heaven spoke to me once more. Go, take the scroll that lies open in the hand of the angel who is standing on the sea and the land. So I went to the angel and asked him to give me the little scroll. He said to me, take it and eat it. It will turn your stomach sour, but in your mouth it will be as sweet as honey. I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and ate it. It tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth, but when I had eaten it, my stomach turned sour. Then I was told, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Lord, like John, give us eyes to see, as our Savior has proclaimed. May you give us ears to hear what your Spirit has to say to your church. For your glory and your kingdom, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, some of you may have noticed that we've jumped from chapter 7 last week to chapter 10 this week. And you may be thinking, Chris, why? Well, the reason is simple. I'm running out of weeks between now and Advent and Christmas. So I need to be selective. But I also don't want us to rush through this rich and complex book in God's Word. And that is why I think it's important for us to take a closer look at this interlude that we find here in chapter 10. You know, when we read this book, we hear all the pronouncements and we visualize the images and we can be quite overwhelmed. But what do you think it would have been like for John? Just think about John and how he would have encountered all this. Imagine taking all of this in firsthand. You know, scenes of multitudes worshiping before the throne, scenes of devastation following the breaking of the seals. You know, it wouldn't be surprising if John just found himself overwhelmed by all of this. But as we come to chapter 10, it's as if all the action around him has frozen for just this brief period of time so that God can reach down into John's life to address him on this personal level. And this really says a lot about the nature of our God, and we should be encouraged by it. It's quite encouraging to us as we go about our daily lives in the midst of the chaos of this world. And I know we continue to feel that in so many ways. But this word has something for us. So our passage contains some really practical and encouraging principles. But to really set the stage first, let's take a few moments to get an overview of this passage. Look at verses 1 through 3 with me. Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. His face was like the sun and his legs were like fiery pillars. He was holding a little scroll, which lay open in his hand. He planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. And he gave a loud shout like the roar of a lion. So the first thing we encounter is this mighty angel. And although some commentators claim that the angel here is Jesus, primarily because there are similarities between the description of the angel here and the description of Jesus in Revelation 1 and in later parts of the book. But the text seems to make it pretty clear that this is not Jesus. Why? Well, first there's the word another at the beginning. Another angel. It really means another of the same kind. It's referring back to the angels that have been described in the previous chapter. Also, secondly, Jesus is really never described as an angel throughout the book of Revelation. So why would we think he would be in this instance? And thirdly, Jesus would not have to take an oath. He wouldn't have to swear an oath like the angel does in verse 6. It says, he swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heavens and the earth and the sea. And so the angel is not Jesus because in his oath he is pointing to Jesus. So Gina, then this is the thing, Jesus really can't be compared to the created angels. even as mighty and glorious as this angel is. No, because our Lord is Creator. He is Redeemer. He's God in the flesh. He is reigning forevermore, the one who reigns. But again, the description of this angel is one of glory and one of grandeur. And the imagery is larger than life, so much so that we can actually miss a critical transition. Look at verses 3 and 4. When he shouted, the angel, the voices of the seven thunders spoke. I heard a voice from heaven say, seal up what the seven thunders have said and do not write it down. The voices of the seven thunders. What do we know about the number seven? Seven is the number of perfection. And thunder is often referenced as a clear pointing to, consistently representing the manifestation of God's presence. We call that a theophany. And even more particularly, to the voice of God. Okay, so this is what we see. The angel is merely the messenger. The Lord is the voice of the seven thunders. Okay, we see that distinction. So the angel appears, the voice thunders, but what is it that John receives? Three things. I'm starting with all M's today. We've got the mighty angel, the mightier voice, and now we come to the first of the three things that John receives, and that is the message. The message. Verse 6, there will be no more delay. Okay, that's the center of what's going on here in this chapter. So, do you remember the martyrs under the altar in heaven crying out to the Lord, how long, O Lord? How long until you vindicate us? Well, this is the moment where God answers their prayers. That the day of the Lord is on its way and it will bring with it the culmination of Christ's kingdom. And we hear the pronouncement in the next chapter. Now again, in our chapter, it talks about the seventh angel and the seventh trumpet. We actually see this come to pass in the very next chapter, in chapter 11, verse 15. The seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of the Lord and his Messiah, and he shall reign forever and ever. Does that sound familiar? He shall reign for. I got Handel's Messiah popped in my head like all through the writing of the sermon. I couldn't get it out. But it's a good one to have in there. So that's the first thing we see. That's the message, that the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of the Lord and his Messiah, the culmination of the kingdom. Okay? So then there's the message, then there's the mystery. Okay, and there's really two elements of mystery in this passage. There's the mystery of God's revelation to John. Specifically to John. When God speaks from heaven, John is about to write down what God has revealed to him when he is commanded to seal it up and not to write it down. So, you know, this causes the questions, well, why? Why couldn't we know? What is going on there? What was it that he saw? You know, I was actually a little amused to read several different commentaries that speculated about what it was that God showed John and why he was told to record it and why he was not tell anyone, not to record it, but just to allow it to stay in that scroll or say what the angel said. And so it's interesting how they had this speculation of what that was that we're not given information about. Though, and it's interesting because I think those attempts to figure out what God has chosen to hide from us really illustrates to me just how uncomfortable we tend to get about this whole idea that there's just some things that God has yet to reveal to us and that we can't figure out. You know, in a sense, we're guilty of the same sin as Adam and Eve committed in the garden, that desire to know everything and to be like God. So we don't need to know. There's a reason why we don't know. It was revealed to John, but he was told to seal it up and to not write it down. So there's the mystery to John, and then there's the mystery of God's plan of redemption. This is what we do know. Verse 7 says, but in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, right? See the description of that in the next chapter. The mystery of God will be accomplished just as he announced to his servants, the prophets. Okay? And so this is the thing. The word mystery, when it's used in the New Testament, refers to something that God has revealed in the past in part, but which finds fuller revelation, fuller disclosure in the person of Jesus Christ. Consider Romans 16, the end of the chapter, verse 25. Now to him who is able to establish you in accordance with the gospel of Jesus Christ, in keeping with the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known. Why? So that all nations might come to the obedience that comes from faith. So that the nations are gathered in. So that they might know salvation in Christ Jesus. That they might know God's redemption. So the mystery of God is his entire plan of redemption. It was first revealed by the prophets. It was further revealed by Jesus in his first coming. And it will be seen in its fulfillment at Christ's return. Okay? So there's the message, there's the mystery, and finally there's the mandates. John is given three more commands or mandates in the last verses of our passage, verses 8 through 11. I'm just going to say them real quick because we're going to dive into them when we do the application. Take the scroll, verse 8. Eat the scroll, verses 9 and 10. And then John, prophesy some more. Prophesy again concerning many peoples, nations, and kings. We say leaders. Okay? So what can we take from all of this? What are some practical ways that we can apply it? Let's consider that for the remainder of our time. Number one, every person is significant to God. You know, up to this point in Revelation, we could easily get the picture that God is so busy carrying out his plan of redemption and judgment that he is either too busy to really take the time or isn't concerned about us as individuals. We see this grand picture throughout Revelation, right? We look at all these different parts that we've read, the messages to the seven ancient churches so long ago, the throne room in heaven filled with all these creatures and numbers, you know, and the events that followed the breaking of the seals, it all seems rather impersonal, right? And we find a lot of numbers mentioned. Four living creatures and 24 elders and 144,000 sealed and the multitudes of redeemed before the throne. But nowhere do we see any focus on individuals. No one is named. But in the midst of all this, we have this interlude. And it is a unique interlude because here God not only pauses to provide more revelation to John, which he does, and it's important, it's key, but also so that he can deal one-on-one with John. You know, perhaps John is a bit stunned by all of this that he's seen so far, as we've mentioned. I know that I would be. So God stops to interact with his beloved, with his child, both to show John that he has this important role to play in God's plan, but also to encourage John to persevere. So as John gives Jesus' revelation to the church to endure and persevere, he's doing the same to John as he gives this vision. And the thing is, we see this pattern repeated throughout the Bible. You know, God most certainly doesn't need us to carry out his purposes, but he graciously involves us. That's how he wants us to do it. And he gives each of us a calling and an equipping and the opportunities to play a part in his redemptive plan. And for the most part, some would say for all of the part, he chooses to use ordinary people to accomplish this. People like you and me. We could talk all day about it. He uses a murderer with a speech impediment to confront Pharaoh and lead his people out of Egypt, out of hundreds of years of bondage. He uses a prostitute to hide the Israelite spies in Jericho. He entrusts his kingdom to a group of fishermen and tax collectors of whom he has placed the responsibility of building his church. Think about that. And it applies to us. If you are a Christ follower, God has given you a unique role for you to play in his plan of redemption. He's given you every tool that you need to accomplish his purposes, that we can be a part. We all have a part to play in building up the body of Christ, in carrying out the work of ministry, in reaching spiritual maturity in Christ Jesus. Each of us is significant to God. Secondly, our relationship with God is developed by feeding on the Word of God. When John is commanded to eat the scroll, it serves as a picture of him taking the word of God and digesting it into his life, absorbing it. And we see a number of examples of this, particularly in the Old Testament. Jeremiah 15, your words were found and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and a delight of my heart. And even more tied to our passage, Ezekiel chapter 3, very similar language here. He said to me, son of man, eat the scroll, then go and speak to the people of Israel. John, go and prophesy now that you've eaten it. Same kind of thing. So I opened my mouth and he gave me the scroll to eat. Then he said to me, son of man, fill your belly with this scroll that I have given you. Fill your stomach with it. So I ate and it tasted as sweet as honey to my mouth. So eating the scroll really is a picture of taking God's word deep into our lives. That it's more than just a cursory reading of God's word, right? Done merely out of a sense of obligation. So thinking about this, right? Think about what happens when you eat something that you really enjoy. Do you just kind of gulp it down and rush on to something else? Pretty tragic if you do, but we sometimes treat the word that way. No, you don't gulp it down. You chew on it. You savor the taste. That's exactly what we need to do, how we need to approach God's word. You need to chew on it. This is what we call meditating on the word of God. You know, to really dive in there. Right? We need to savor it and really learn all that we can about it. We need to see how other passages in the Bible give flavor to what we're reading. And then, after we've done all that chewing, we need to integrate what we learn into our lives. We don't just eat for eating's sake. That is to empower us, to energize us, to give us the strength to live our lives. With the Word of God, it is to be integrated. Paul put it this way, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, with thankfulness in your hearts to God. That word dwell in you richly, that word dwell means to take up permanent residence. We know that with the Holy Spirit, that the Spirit comes to indwell in us permanently. But here Paul's talking about having the Word of God dwell in us richly. Now think about this, when you have guests over, they visit, but they don't take up permanent residence. Thank goodness, right? They're visiting. You know, once our fellowship is over, they leave. And since they are your guests, you don't really expect them to have any responsibility in the upkeep of your house. But since you are the permanent resident, you have those daily responsibilities to keep it clean. Or at least we try. Some days better than others, right? The same applies to God's word. If we merely treat the word as a guest, then it really doesn't have much of a permanent impact on our lives. But if the word is that permanent resident, then we will be adjusting our lives every day in a manner that is pleasing to God. As we meditate on the word and chew on it, it will have that impact upon us. Okay, so it's simply not possible to truly feed on God's word by merely tasting a morsel of it every Sunday. That's just not enough to sustain us all week. We need to be in God's word daily, taking that time to chew it over and to savor that which God is revealing to us. Okay, third, our obedience identifies us as Christ followers. What do I mean by that? Well, in this passage, John is given commands. We can almost miss that, but this one chapter of 11 verses is filled with commands. When commanded to seal up the word spoken by the thundering voice of God, John obeys. When commanded to take and to eat the scroll, John obeys. When commanded to go and prophesy, John obeys. And this is the thing, obeying God is not always easy. In fact, obedience often comes at a very high price, and nowhere is this more clearly seen than in the life of our Savior Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John's Gospel, chapter 4, my food is to do the will of the one who has sent me and to accomplish his work. And then the Apostle Paul later goes on to say, describes what the cost of that obedience was. Philippians 2, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's what obedience costs our Savior. So as John obeyed the commands one after another, I wonder if he thought back to the words of Jesus, you know, that he had recorded in his gospel decades before. Jesus showed his love for us by being obedient to the Father, even to offering his life for us. But he also would remember those chapters, the time in the upper room. He really dives into it, John, in those chapters, and what Jesus says. And he reveals something about how we love him. Jesus says in John 14, "Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me." That those can never be severed. That we can say that we love Jesus, but the true test, the indicator of whether or not we are Christ's followers, is if we are obeying him. It's the mark, the evidence of it. It is our obedience to Jesus that distinguishes us, that serves as that witness to an unbelieving world. John obeyed. We're called to as well. Next, being a Christ follower is a bittersweet experience. We see this in our passage. The scroll that John ate was sweet at first, but then it made his stomach bitter. Kind of like eating some really tasty Mexican food only to get heartburn later on. Okay, that's a bad example. But there are so many things in our life in Christ that are sweet. The forgiveness of sins, right? The presence of his Holy Spirit. The gospel displayed in our life. The assurance of eternity in the presence of our Savior. All of this sweetness is a direct result of feeding on the Word of God, where we learn about these wonderful gifts from God. But there is also a sense in which the Word of God brings a taste of bitterness in our lives. And we can experience this in a very personal way, that as we dig deep into God's Word, God often uses it to reveal areas of our lives where we have drifted, where we have strayed from Him, where change is needed, where repentance is required. And we know that correction can be a painful and bitter thing. But I think the bitterness that John experienced in our passage is different. It's different from that. As he saw God's plans unfold before him, he really became sick to his stomach for what he saw. When he saw the fate of those who refused to repent and turn to God. As he saw people unwilling to turn from their idolatry. As he saw people who prayed for the mountains to fall on them as a desperate attempt to avoid greater judgment. John's heart was broken because he discerned their destruction. This is where that bitterness, that turning of stomach is. Like John, our hearts should be broken. Our hearts should break as we encounter hardened hearts who have rejected the grace of Jesus Christ. Our stomachs should become bitter over it. And that sick feeling in our gut should be our motivation to model the last principle. Number five, what we have been given is not just for us. It must be shared. It has to be passed on to others. Although God did reveal that there were some things that were for John only, they were not to be passed on. Seal up that scroll. The main message about God's plan of redemption was not something for John to keep to himself. John is commanded to prophesy again. God is giving the peoples and nations and leaders of this world the opportunity to respond to his grace before that final judgment. We don't want to miss that last part of the passage. We can get caught up in what's not revealed, what stays a mystery, and miss what he's been commanded to give. So those of us who are Christ followers have been given the greatest treasure. But this treasure is not just so that we can enjoy it, that we can possess this newness of life and joy and peace that accompany it. No, this treasure of treasures must be offered to others. Otherwise, we're not being faithful with it. You know, we may not know exactly when Jesus will return, but we do know that that day is one day closer than it was yesterday. And we also don't know when we will come to the end of our physical life here on earth and when that opportunity to respond to Christ's grace will pass us by, will be gone. And that's why we need to heed the words of Paul. Now, we see in Ephesians chapter 5, and think about these words anew right now. Be very careful how you live. And often we think about how our actions benefit us. But we need to think much larger than that. Be careful how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity. Why? Because the days are evil. I don't think any of us would deny that. But are we living wise? Are we making the most of every opportunity? I want to ask you as we close to be praying for at least one individual who does not know Christ as Savior, who hasn't surrendered themselves to Him as Lord. I want you to pray for this individual every day this week, asking God to work in their life, to draw them closer to Him. And you can, I encourage you to write that name down. If you have access to our sermon notes and you printed that off, you can write it on that, or just a piece of paper. Write down that name, place it somewhere so that you don't forget. And then ask God to make you wise, so that you can make the most of every opportunity to proclaim the love and the life of our Savior Jesus Christ. So this is the summary. Every person is significant to God. If you're already a Christ follower, then God wants you to be His co-worker in ushering in His kingdom. But in order to be equipped to do that, we need to feed daily upon His word, and we need to obey what we learn there. But there is also a whole world of other people out there who are significant to God as well. And He desires that not one perish. That is why we must be urgent in sharing, urgent in passing on to others the gift of Jesus Christ, the Lamb who was slain for us, the One who conquered death for us, the One who is now reigning over us. Praise be to the Father and to the Lamb. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord, show us, teach us, use us. We thank You that by Your grace, You've called us to be a part of Your plan that has nothing to do with our ability, but all to do with Your grace, all to do with Your desire. And so, Lord, we pray that You give us wisdom, and that You give us compassion, and that You give us a sense of urgency to respond, to offer our lives, to proclaim to others the One who has redeemed. We pray in His name, our Savior Jesus. Amen and amen. So as we feed upon God's word, we get this sense of how great our God is. So let's sing that now. How great Thou art. Now let's pray together. This is a time of, before we start to pray, again, this is the time of the service where we dedicate unto the Lord our gifts. So this is the time where you can bring your offering, your tithe, your giving unto the Lord, setting it apart for His purposes, giving thanks for His blessing and provision, trusting Him and the work that He's going to accomplish through our giving and through our living as well. And we want to thank you. Thank you for supporting the life and the ministry of the church and for your love shown through that. So let us pray. Let us pray together. Lord, we do come before you and we set apart these gifts for your purposes, trusting in you, the one who has given, to use it for your kingdom and your glory, and that you use our lives as well. We thank you that you have given us the greatest of treasures. May we never take it for granted. May we never hoard them to ourselves, but may we be those like John who pass it on to others. So Lord, we do. We dedicate ourselves and our gifts unto you. And Lord, in this time, we also thank you. We thank you for the gift, the greatest of gifts, the gifts of life eternal. And for all those who, having served you well, now rest from their labors. We thank you for all the saints remembered and the ones forgotten. For those dear souls most precious to us. Lord, teach us to follow their faithful example. God, we are grateful that you have claimed us as your own by your grace. Lord, you have set us in the company of saints, past and present, among those who have made bold witness to your goodness and to your truth. Lord, you know the places in our hearts where we are afraid. Afraid of a future we cannot control. Afraid of a future as families, as a nation. Afraid of losing health and independence. Afraid of for the well-being of our children. Afraid that past mistakes will ruin our future. Lord, write the stories of your people deep into our hearts so that we may learn to trust you beyond our fears. Give us hearts and minds ready to trust and follow wherever your Spirit leads, confident that you will not lead us beyond your loving embrace. And let us be ever thankful that we are your saints, neither by our own inclination nor by our own strength, but simply by the call and the holiness of Christ Jesus, our Savior. And we ask in Jesus' name, whose outstretched arms welcome us and hold us securely in your grace. We pray in the name of the one who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We want to remind you that we will be celebrating communion together via River Launch Facebook page, Facebook Live, at 11:30. We encourage you to join us and have those elements prepared. In just a moment, Pam will be offering our postlude selection, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And just marvel at that love. Marvel at that love and share that love with others. And we leave you with this blessing. Again, we heard it from Romans 16 earlier. Now to Him who is able to establish you in accordance with the gospel of Jesus Christ, to the only wise God be glory forever and ever. Amen. Thanks be to God. Pray the Lord's blessing on you. We thank you for worshiping with us. We hope to see you again.